Mr. Ron Simmons.
Hi everyone, what's up?
Jay here, obviously. Back at it again with a freshie. Today, we're talking about the new GoPro Hero 7 Black Edition. What plan though?
I got it a couple weeks ago. Been fiddling with it, getting all up in its bits. Been testing out all the new features and stuff that GoPro brought along with the new camera. So there was Hypersmooth, which is similar to old GoPro stabilization, but it's much better. Then there is higher frame rates. So now I've got up to 240 frames per second, which is
mahoosive.
And overall, it just seems to be like a freaking awesome new camera. So I am stoked to try it out, and hopefully this video I will be able to show off those features and compare them to my old session and see, is it actually worth buying the new Hero 7, or is your old 5 or 6 or anything like that still perfectly fine to use? Hokily dokily, so I'm gonna get my computer and then I'll be able to watch it while you're watching it and give some running commentary and my thoughts on the video as we are going through it, just to keep it a little bit shorter. So I'll get my computer. There we go. My first shot is of this morning. I was just going down to get some soy milk from the shop. So I had the two GoPros mounted together. It's got some tape wrapped around. And I've got the... God damn! I've got the Hero 7 on the left of screen, then the Hero 5 session on the right of screen. But heavens almighty! All right, so... Oh, okay, well, there you go. So straight off the bat, you've got ridiculously smooth image from the Hero 7 compared to the Session 5. I'm also noticing it's a little bit lighter, like the dynamic range has given the Hero 7 like a lighter image than the Session 5, which is odd because I tend to drop the shadows in a lot of my videos in post-production, so I don't know, this is all on the stock settings, stock GoPro settings, so 1080p, 60 frames per second, stabilization on the Hero 7 and off on the Session 5, just to show how much stabilization the Hero 7 has in comparison to without stabilization. So it shouldn't really compare the actual images, rather compare the stabilization that's happening. So we'll go on with that. Yeah, ridiculously better there, blah, blah, blah.
Dokily, dokily, artichokily.
Oh yeah, okay, so I stuffed up here. So because I wrapped the GoPros in tape, there's a microphone mounted on the top and a microphone mounted on the side. And that meant that when I taped it up, I actually covered the microphone, so you couldn't actually hear anything. So all this audio in this section is gonna be from the Hero 5 session.
Now I've got both cameras with their respective stabilization on. Gonna pick myself up some soy milk. So this would be interesting to see how much of a difference the stabilization compares to each other.
Okay, so in that walking scene there, the stabilization was on the Session 5, it was on the Hero 7. And there wasn't a ridiculous amount of difference. Like the Hero 5, it looks kind of more natural, I guess you could say. So the Hero 7 is, they're marketing it as like a gimbal without having to use an actual gimbal. So it does look a little bit unnatural, but you know, if you like that, then go for your life, like grab it. But
those would be interesting to see how much.
Yeah, it kind of the 5 gives a little bit more like natural motion. It looks a little bit more realistic, as to like me actually holding the camera versus the gimbal like stabilization of the 7.
Compares to each other, because there's big talk about the whatever this stabilization is called. So it'd be interesting how much of a difference it actually makes.
Isn't that right? Okay, yeah, alright, so this is a cool shot. We've got the Hero Session up first, and it looks alright, but the actual image it yields is ridiculously different. So, stock settings, GoPro color, like, Pro Tune is off, all of it's just what you'd get straight out of the box. It all looks alright, but then you cross over into that Hero 7, and Jesus Christ, everything just, like, pops. And that's, I think, what I'm liking so far about the 7. You know, I will do post-production on a lot of the shots I get, obviously, but for someone who doesn't actually want to do any of that stuff, getting those colors straight out of the camera, thumbs up from your boy. Thumbs up from your boy so far. So, yeah, colors,
Carl's doing well. So on the motorbike, I was holding the cameras just like this. So they are going to be a little bit more dampened than if they were mounted on something. I wonder how I could test that out. I know. So here I'm just watching now the video that I took recently. My parents came over, I took them out to Kawaputi volcanic crater.
Oh, it doesn't matter, does it?
Climbing up the mountain and... Yeah, okay. So the audio, when you've been flying and playing around with these drones for a while, you can tell by the sound that the actual GoPro gets as to the tune of it. If it's like a constant whine in the audio from the GoPro, then it kind of portrays the fact that, oh my God, it's quiet. It kind of portrays the fact that the tune is pretty good because there's little oscillations, there's small vibrations, you know, it's actually okay, so the image is quite good. In this one, the audio that I'm getting is completely different. It doesn't actually sound like it's tuned very well, and in a matter of fact, it isn't. Like, I got the camera the day before this, chucked it on the quad, and then flew it. I didn't change any settings, and that affects how the quad flies. So it will affect it, and I can hear that, but the image looks like I'm Johnny FPV, which is not true. So it's fantastic. This is shot in 2.7K, 60 frames per second with SuperView in 16:9 aspect ratio, which I'll get into that a little bit later on. What really like impresses me here is the dynamic range. So the dynamic range is the contrast between the lights in the image and the darks in the image. So typically, let's say you're underneath some tree canopies, you're riding my bike, the darks on an older camera and on the 7 5 in particular, the darks get really dark and the lights get really light and sometimes get blown out. In this image, it's quite good. Like the tree land below contrasts nicely with the sky up above. It doesn't look like any of it's actually like fighting each other to work out who's getting the most contrast and dynamic range, so it looks really nice. And like apart from the slight rolls that you get from the drone not having any stabilization on it, you know, it looks like a Phantom or a Mavic or something like that. The image can be dead still, vibration free, but it's really heavy. The camera alone weighs 120 grams. That's a lot. There's an ant on my lens. That's a lot of weight to add to not a very heavy drone. So it does affect the flight characteristics, and you're probably not going to be doing any acrobatic stuff like this with the Hero 7 on your quad. That just, unless you've got a ridiculously powerful quad, then all for you, but yeah, unfortunately it might not fit the bill. Alrighty, so that's Hypersmooth. Oh, okay, so Hyperlapse, Hypersmooth. I love the word hyper, GoPro. Hyperlapse, if you don't know, like filmmaking is when you were to set up a tripod with your DSLR camera on the top. Ooh, time-lapse kind of motion that's nice and smooth, seamless, beautiful, right? What GoPro's done is made it a hell of a lot easier. This shot here was the first hyperlapse that I actually did. Now, I shot it in 2.7K in a 4x3 aspect ratio image, and I think it was a 30-second interval? I can't remember. But anyway, watch this. That is handheld, and I was not paying attention to how smooth I was keeping the camera. Pretty good. A nice little addition to your vlogs. And I'll be going to India very shortly, and I'm keen to try this out at the Taj Mahal. So I'm excited to see what else I can get from the Hero 7 with Hyperlapse. Right, now continuing on from Hypersmooth, Hyperlapse, the other awesome feature that I'm super stoked about with the new GoPro camera is the high frame rates. Now, previously, I've had the GoPro Hero 2, GoPro Hero 3 Black, GoPro Hero 4 Black, GoPro Hero 5 Session, and then the GoPro 7 Black. Slow motion features have been pretty good. You know, like 120 frames per second sometimes. 60 is all right for most things. Okay, that's what I shoot on this, 60 frames per second. It's pretty good. I can slow everything down if I want to. But this GoPro can do 1080p at 240 frames per second. So my dad and I went out to an arcade and we were messing around with the camera. It was the first time I actually used it properly. There was this bloke and he was playing this game, whatever. And I shot it 1080p, 240 frames per second. And my heavens, watch this. That dude's hands, and I'll play the other shot, like in fast forward, watch that. His hands are faster than Usain Bolt's bloody feet. He can stab that boy. He goes like a stabbed rat, even though I'm against stabbing rats. I'm against stabbing rats. But carrots don't run fast. And then just like this shot here. I'm so stoked. The amount of possibilities that you have to get awesome shots with slow motion. Take me money. Actually, they did. They took my money, and it was quite a lot of money. Retails for about 600 Australian bucks. Ouch! All right, now moving on. So it's not a new feature, it's not an old feature, but it's a feature on the new GoPro 7. And it's a little bit confusing at start and a little bit difficult if you haven't got a specific gear that actually allows you to use these features. So previously on GoPro cameras, you've had 720p, 960, whoever used that, 1080p, 1440p, 2.7k, 4k, blah, blah, blah. 1440p and 960, they were shot in a 4:3 aspect ratio image. So you're getting a bigger image, but that bigger image is more of a square rather than what we're traditionally used to seeing, which is 16:9, which is widescreen, which is what you're watching this on. It isn't actually available on all computers and all phones. Originally had on my computer, which is a Mac from 2015 or 16 or whatever. The original software that came with it, so I had to update my computer. Bit of a shame. I have an iPhone 6, it doesn't work on that either. Bit of a shame. So, if you wanted to shoot in 4:3, take that into consideration. So you're gonna have to either have an updated computer, or a newish phone. But what 4:3 actually does is it allows you to get a higher image. So typically, if I'm gonna post something to YouTube, I'll definitely always shoot in a widescreen in a 1080p, a 2.7K or a 4K image. But now, the fact that the GoPro can shoot in 4:3, I might start using that a little bit more often when I'm specifically wanting to make videos to put on Instagram. I can make the image a little bit taller and still maintain that same width, and it will just be so much easier to watch because you don't have to like squeeze your eyes out and like try and watch what's actually on the screen. So I think that's a fantastic feature on the new cameras if you're able to use it. Thumbs up there. What else? How long are we doing? 29 minutes. I think that's gonna conclude it. I've been rambling on for very too long. I apologize, but if you've come this long, you're either interested in the GoPro itself, and if that's the case, I would recommend comparing it to the Hero 6 and then seeing if the stabilization is something that you actually want, because that's the main feature of the new camera. So thank you very much for watching. Hope this has been somewhat insightful. I've got a plan for the next video that's going to come out. I had one of my mates, oh, for crying out loud, can someone film a video here? I had one of my mates contact me about getting jitters in his GoPro footage. And we worked out that it was his frame rates and his NTSC/power was a little bit off. So that's going to be the next video that I make, so stick around for that. Selamat siang. I'll see you in the next video.